Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence, grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips, grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God, grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts, grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, so by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. I welcome you here. This is the last Sunday of the Epiphany season. After this, we go into purple for a rather extended period. Today, all of these beautiful flowers after Mass have to come off of the altar. So if anybody wants to save a little bit of money on Valentine's, you got a beautiful red salad that goes all to your loved ones right there. And they do come back. They're really a hardy plant. So if you like them, please take them after Mass, because otherwise it's really sad. I got to throw them into a garbage bag, and it's a pity. But next week, all the flowers have to come off the altar as we enter into pre-Lent. And I also know that today is that Super Bowl Sunday, and I've also got orders not to say any specific prayers, because God kind of teases me. And if I say a special prayer for something, usually it goes the other way. So I shan't say a prayer in favor of any team today. But when you're sending all those prayers up to heaven for whichever team you're rooting for, I know there's a lot of Super Bowl squares and et cetera out there. There's money going back and forth. There's team spirit. You know, throw in some of the other things that are going on in the world today as well, because there's a lot of stuff that, you know, needs our special prayer attention. So the Super Bowl is a lot of fun. It's important. But there's a lot of other stuff. And one of those other things is that there's an awful lot of people right in our very own neighborhoods that are hungry. And I mean, literally, they don't know sometimes where their next meal is going to come from. I've been to the Franklin County Survival Center, and Pat Blakes goes a lot more than I do. And sometimes you go there and you make the deliveries, and you'll see the people that are coming in for the just a can of food or something like that. These are not people that are just milking the system. These are people that really need a little bit of extra help just to have something simple on their table. So a youth group, I don't know how many years ago, on Super Bowl Sunday, they did this Super Bowl of Caring, and it somehow took off, the national effort, and it's got like $10 million it's raised so far, and we're a little part of that. Whatever we do today helps the Franklin County Survival Center, so it helps our neighbors. 100% of everything that we collect goes directly into this, and there's no overhead for Super Bowl of Caring. So if you would like to help out in that way, if you brought any kind of non-perishable food items, thank you so much. But it's amazing what they can do with a dollar. I don't know how they do it, but their dollar can stretch so much farther than whatever we can buy at the store ourselves. So on the way out of the church this morning, I do hope that you can be as generous as you possibly can, if you so choose, so we can help those of our neighbors who simply don't know where some of their next meal is going to come from. So, today on this Super Bowl Sunday, Super Bowl of Care. Yes, Pat?
I'm going to give it a couple of weeks.
To make the delivery?
For the next 2 weeks.
Okay. And if there's any checks, by the way, I did get a couple of emails. The checks will be made out to Holy Name. We'll pass it through our books and then off to the Franklin County Survival Center so that we can keep a track of that as well. So if you are making a check donation, make it out to the church, and then we'll pass it through and directly over to them. So as we do gather today for the celebration of Mass, I ask you at this time to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, martyrs, and faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that of purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. Amen. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have chosen us to be the salt of the earth, the instruments for salvation. Grant us the grace to abstain from actions of wickedness, so we may feast on the favor of your love. We ask this for our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. Is not this the fast that I chose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. When your light shall break forth like the dawn and your healing shall spring up quickly, your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your regard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, If you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom will be like the noonday. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Lord, hear my prayer. Let my cry come to you. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
For you were once dark, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of God. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. She cleansed the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be my heart and not my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the holy gospel according to St. Matthew. And Jesus said, You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its taste, with what can it be seasoned? It is no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world, a city set on a mountain that cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and then put it under a bushel basket. It is set high on a lampstand where it gives light to all in the house. Just so, your light must shine before all others, that they may see your good deeds, and then glorify your heavenly Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. Proclamation, and in them Jesus lays out the necessities of Christianity. It's Christianity 101. Today we hear the very next words that make up that Sermon on the Mount, and they are Jesus' encouragement for us to take our Christianity 101, the basics of our faith. We are to take them seriously, and we are to do this by showing the world that we believe in them by the way we live. Today, there is a sacred and a secular component to our lives. Back in Jesus' day, and for most of history since then, there was no such distinction between church or religion and then the regular society outside of that. But in Jesus' day, we need to remember, his understanding of the sacred was not the normal one. It was not the state religion. And Jesus didn't argue for it to become so either. Give unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, he said, and unto God the things that are God's.
is what Jesus said. There's a distinction. Give to Jesus, I mean, give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. But God's is a separate realm. You know, you don't legislate or use the police to force the sacred on the secular. You use the example, a better example, to convince people that the sacred is what they need in their lives. The sacred infuses the secular, not through politics, but by the way that believers live. I remember back in the 1960s, I was in elementary school, and I think this memory is real, even though it's so long ago. I remember seeing a stack of Bibles loaded on the back shelf of one of my classrooms. They weren't used in school anymore when I was there, but I imagine that they were there because they were used not too many years prior. They were sitting there because I think it's not easy to get rid of Bibles. You don't simply throw them away in the garbage, and, you know, who do you give Bibles to from the school? So they were sitting there because they hadn't yet figured out how to get rid of the Bibles. And a lot of people saw this. When you couldn't read the Bible in church or school, you couldn't say prayers in school, they saw this as the beginning of the end of religion in America. But no one forbade children from reading the Bible on their own. No police would dare walk into a house and forbid a mother or a father from sharing a parable or a miracle story. No one stopped a child from going to Sunday school. If kids no longer knew the Bible, it was not the school's fault, it was the fault of believers. Today's gospel is Jesus telling us that it's no one else's job to spread the faith besides the people of the faith. Jesus didn't go to King Herod, he didn't go to Pilate, the Roman governor, he didn't tell them you have to make the people believe this way or else, because you can't force faith on people. He laid out the Beatitudes of what Christianity is all about, and then he told the ones who were going to believe, now it's your job to go out and spread this message. His first example of this is the familiar one. He says, we are the salt of the earth. Salt is a preservative. The ancient people used it to keep food longer, to keep it safe. And this is why salt is also used in the sacrament of baptism. A pinch of salt is given to the one who wishes to enter the church to symbolize that that grace of baptism is shared to preserve and to protect them from sin. So that as they come into the church, they are stronger in the faith. But if salt loses its taste, it does so by dilution. At some point, if more and more water is added to the salt, you don't taste the salt anymore. If we are the salt of the earth, if we as baptized Christians are supposed to preserve and protect ourselves and also our neighbors and our world, and yet we keep diluting our faith, if we keep forsaking our purpose, if we accept more and more compromises with the worldliness so around us, then our faith and our church and we ourselves become diluted, and then that faith can't do what it's supposed to do. The Beatitudes call us to be humble. They call us to be righteous and pure and merciful, even peacemakers. If we don't live a life of faith that these virtues in themselves demonstrate, then we've watered down our faith to the point where it no longer means anything. Jesus isn't the first to say this either. It was said hundreds of years earlier by a prophet that scholars call 3rd Isaiah. Israel is returning home after a long exile. They're coming back to a destroyed country. They are themselves an impoverished people. And the prophet shares God's message with them that faith and worship are not only what we do at the altar. Instead, says God, deal with injustice and oppression, and these make them right. That is part of your worship. Don't bother bragging about a faith if you can't see that other people are hurting around you. Doesn't worship mean to share your bread with the hungry, says God, and to bring the homeless poor into your house, says God. These aren't additions to the faith. These are as much a part of the faith as what we do here at the altar. And I ask you to think about that seriously as today we accept for the last time our donations for the Super Bowl of Caring. Helping the helpless is not a second thought of religion. It is a full and necessary expression of how we worship God. We don't have to do this through making a donation today to the Super Bowl of Caring, but in some way as Christians, we have to do it. We can't ignore that part of our faith. Or how about that our faith is supposed to shine like a city on a hill? I don't think any of us here have not heard about all of the commotion over immigration that the president's ban a week ago Friday initiated. Immigration is a hot political topic right now, but it's also a moral one. Catholic charities across the country, evangelical Protestant church groups across the country, Jewish organizations across the country are just some of the groups who have all been working together to try and relocate at least some of the world's refugees here in our country. And this wide-ranging group is acting because they see the despair and the hardship among these families as a moral obligation. So during this immigration debate, we've probably seen the signs being held and carried that remind us that we're all immigrants here in the United States. And back in 1630, John Winthrop, the leader of the Puritans, preached to the others who were coming to this land for the very first time that we would become a city built on a hill. And he was quoting the exact same words that we read as part of today's gospel, and he was using them to define our entire way of life, not only an occasional Sunday morning. Winthrop used Jesus' imagery to characterize the countless endeavors being part of a special pact of God to create a holy community. He encouraged the colonists to bear one another's burdens and to view themselves as the company of Christ bound together by love. Jesus expected his first followers to be an example of beatitudes to all of those around them. And likewise, this country of ours began with that same expectation that we would be a faith that was lived so convincingly it would be like a city built on a hill, drawing other people to our shores by our example. Christianity is still that kind of faith that is lived every day and every moment. We may live up to the sacred calling by the way that we live, by what we do here as church, as worship, and also by what we do every day of our lives as worship. And for this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Sunday across the nation and churches all across our land have been asked to offer this prayer. O God, your will is that all children should grow into fullness of life. We lift to you the ministry of scouting. We offer you thanks for camping to teach us that the entire world is our great home, for study and work to build character, for service to see our responsibility to all of those in need, for encouragement in genuine patriotism and vital faith. Bless the work of scouting in this place and around the world, that through its efforts the young may, like our Lord, increase in wisdom and in stature and in favor with you and all people. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We also offer our prayers at this time for Marshall Aaron's Day. Thursday, February 2nd, was the third anniversary of his death. This is offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We also offer prayers on the 100th anniversary of the birth of Edward Benjamin, who would have been 100 years old on February 6th of this year. We also continue to offer our prayers for Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, also for Liz Bridgman, and who was diagnosed with cancer and is raising 3 young girls on her own, and those prayers are being offered by Cindy Benjamin. We also continue to offer our prayers for the following who are battling cancer: Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Brandy Clemens by grandmother Dottie Baronis, fathers Ray Drayton, Maurice Lazelle, and also Bishop Thomas Gannat is offered by myself. Also, we offer prayers for Richard Poe, is offered by the Poe and Foster families, and 2-year-old Jack Seela is offered by Marianne Foster. And then lastly, we also offer prayers for Frank Sprosky, the brother of Don Sprosky. This is offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any other prayers that you would like to offer from the congregation? For all of these prayers, Lord, bless the private ones that we bring before you at this time. And we ask you, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I count one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Shall not omit from your grain offerings the salt of the covenant with your God. All your offerings you shall add salt.
Father.
Amen. Lord God,
accept these gifts and season us with the salt of the covenant, that we may be both preserved in the way of truth and also speak your wisdom to all others. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. He freed us from sin and death, and called us to the glory that has made us a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people set apart. Everywhere we proclaim your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. Therefore the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, 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 God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide them throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Lord, remember your servants. This congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those. We are the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless number of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promises this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me,
that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have with me in my company, where I would see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words, the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angels to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who are in life straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Amen.
us, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and future, and by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days. Supported by the help of your mercy, may we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom. For you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment, though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but I will say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given to me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord. I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but I will say the word, and I shall be healed.
Bye.
God who has on Christ. Peace be with us, the God, the Father, the Spirit, and the body, and the Son of God. The body, and the blood of Christ. 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 Body and the blood of Christ. The 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 body and the blood of Christ. And the body and the blood of Christ. The body and the blood of Christ. The body and the blood of Christ.
Thank you.
Keep salt in yourselves, and you will have peace with one another. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, satisfied now with the true heavenly bread of this Mass, may we be excited in spirit, joyful in hope, and zealous in your service. We ask it for our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lo, the sacrifice is offered.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered up in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came to be, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, power to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.